Welcome back to my bonus videos of Torment, Tides of Numenera. I'm the RPG chick. We have two more Merecasters we have to find. The first one is here in the necropolis.
Yes.
See, she knows. Well, I'm currently in tomb 5143. That's where we want to be. Oh, I guess we have to take it from him.
On it.
As you poke through the supplies, Oddwald howls, "How do I put my fingers in your brain? Leave it alone now. How do you plan to stop me?" "Through words and suasion. I hope it won't come to violence. My fragile bones aren't good for that." "Words won't work. Make me stop or watch me take something." See, I would never do this. Because, yeah, that's evil. We're stealing from the poor guy. What did he ever do to us? You! He sputters, and then realizes that he's getting dangerously close to you. He yelps, grabs a handful of his junk, and disappears from the room. You're not quite sure how he left. Looks like he teleported. He didn't take everything, though. You find an oddly shaped item amongst what's left. It's the electrostatic Merecaster.
Yes.
You poke through the supplies but find nothing else of worth. So, that's what I didn't explore. Here I thought I hadn't been to the tomb at all. Oh, but I had. Electrostatic Merecaster. Energy crackles across this lattice of interlinking tetrahedrons, a dull energy that flows around your hand rather than through it. The frames themselves seem to be made of bone, each without crack or joint. At its heart is a ring of silver ingots wrapped in solenoids that presumably are somehow generating the charge. You grip the device in both hands, and energy flows over your skin. Pinpricks of cold dot your flesh, as though invisible rain is falling from the sky. At the center of the tetrahedrons, a light grows, the gateway to the mirror within the device. Inspect. The more you hold the device in your hands, the more you feel that it does not like being held or observed, that it resents being studied as though it is a dead, inert thing, and yet there is no evidence that this device is alive in any way. Enter the mirror. Silver rain pours down on a cratered wasteland, beating endlessly on your headgear and turning the road into a red slurry that cakes onto your boots and your leggings. Trudging behind you are 30 miserable soldiers, glaives mostly, all as soaked as you are, and all as heavily laden with weapons and gear. 6 are even more weighed down, lugging between them a heavy crate that makes them plunge shin-deep in the muck with every step. The only person without a pack walks behind you, flanked by the company's toughest veterans, a scrawny Aeon priest whose robes are somehow neither wet nor muddy, but who seems more put out by the rain than anyone else. "Why was I not retrieved in a vehicle?" he asks. "Why am I being escorted home by poorly armed grunts? If this is what command thinks of my work, maybe I should sell it to the enemy." The woman marching beside you sighs. She has a lieutenant's pips on her tunic and a scar on her right cheek from temple to jaw. "No vehicles available," she says, "and no other companies. Thanks to the Chalcedon's assault, every other company fit to fight is marching straight for inXile." With a curse, one of the men carrying the priest's package sinks to his waist in the mud. The column stops while the soldiers try to extricate him. Your lieutenant stands at attention. The priest watches with a smirk. Let's look around the wasteland. Let's just look at these other... How's our side weathering? The assault. Yeah, let's look around. The landscape on either side of the road is as blasted and barren as the surface of a moon. Long abandoned trenches, whether your sides or the enemy's you can't tell, snake away into the obscuring rain in both directions like the furrows of a tilled field. With the half-buried forms of giant broken battle constructs rising above them like rusted mountains. But these are the only features you can see. For 10 generations, these fields have known no seed but skulls, not all of them human, and no irrigation but the blood of soldiers and cast-offs. How is our side weathering the Chalcedon's assault, Lieutenant? I'm afraid we're getting our heads handed to us on all fronts, Captain, and if it succeeds, the bastards will have our backsides, too. Not the best time to take our leave, I suppose. Or maybe the absolute best time, depending on how you look at it. She peers into the rain behind you. Bastille should be back with updated info soon, if he gets back at all. Tell me about this work of yours, priest. As if a glaive like you could even begin to understand. But very well. I have basically taken a standard wave projector and coupled it with a resonance echolocation device and a self-canceling oscillator to make a weapon that can overamp nearby energy weapons and cause them to suffer spontaneous ignition. Or, to put words even you might understand, I made a weapon that makes the enemy's weapons blow up. And why wouldn't this weapon blow up friendly weapons as well? He gives you a sidelong glance. That is a more perceptive question than I would have given you credit for. The answer is the shielding I created, which makes sure the rays only spread from the front of the gun. Indeed, I was out here in No Man's Land for the specific purpose of field testing it when... He hesitates for a moment, then continues, more subdued. It seems the shielding had a flaw that presented itself when the weapon heated up. The first few shots worked just fine, but after too many, he shrugs. That is why I required the rescue. The company I was traveling with... Well, yes. I don't know. Should we march and hold till Vastille returns? Let's march on. We were marching to begin with. I'm not dead set on it. I'm just not sure which one to pick. You press on through the dismal landscape, but after less than a mile, a harsh whine penetrates the hiss of the rain. It's Vastille, says your lieutenant, looking around, back from his sweep. Oh, good. He caught up with us anyway. Vastille skims in on a small pod hovering in the air. He stops in front of you, pulls off his goggles, and salutes. Luck's holding, Captain, he says. Early leave, and now this. I intercepted a courier with an interesting dispatch on him. Seems the unit that holds Barhard's monolith has been reduced to 10 men by an attack from a rogue construct. Lay down the bastard, but it's near to wipe them. He grins at your lieutenant. Landy will object, but if we move now, we could secure it before the Chalcedon knows it's threatened. Commander Reckon's been wanting that vantage for a year. Wouldn't that be a feather in your cap? Of course I object, says Landy. We have our orders. We should stick to them. Why go hunting uncertain glory when we'll already get a commendation for bringing in the priest and his invention? Escorting the priest will get us a pat on the head, says Vastille. So will taking the monolith, but it'll also win us the envy of every other company. Do you know how many cast-offs have died trying to win that damn thing back for the side? We'll be heroes. Your lieutenants look back at you. What do you say, Captain? Asks Vastille. Good behavior never won glory, you know that. And it never lost honor, either, says Landy. Well, I could go with Landy, follow our orders, and take the priest to the headquarters, or... I could go with Vastille, and take a small squad. Landy will stay with the company, or... Yeah, I'm kind of for it, but this is more of a cautious route. Very tempting, but I need more information. Vastille, send a scout to check out the monolith. The company will wait here. One of Vastille's scouts rides off into the rain, and the company settles in, the men sitting on their packs or else patrolling the battlefield in wide circles around you. Though Vastille assures you the monolith is only a few kilometers away, the scout fails to return after an hour. You can wait no longer. The evening is turning the rain from silver to slate, and soon the endless trenches and dead constructs that flank the road will vanish beyond your sights. Beyond your lights, rather. But as you stand to give an order, you hear a cry from one of the patrols, swiftly silenced. What was that? Asks Vastille. I better go check. You'll wait for orders, curse you, says Landy. Captain, what should we do? Oh, don't even have a choice here. Before you can issue a command, beams of light sizzle from the rusted corpse of a massive Titan-classed battle construct lying in the trenches to your left. More fire comes from either side of it. Strangely, however, all the beams lance over your heads. Ambush! Shouts Landy. Find cover! To hell with cover! Let's take him! Cries Vastil. A voice interrupts them, amplified by some crude and screechy artifact. Send the priest and a Numenera to us and your men will be spared. Defy us and all will die. The Aeon priest squeals from where he lies curled up on the ground. Don't you dare give me up, you filth! I'm worth more than all your insignificant lives combined. Landy, fall back to the trenches and protect the priest. Just need a drink. Vastil, you'll pick 4 scouts and come with me. Or, everyone fall back to the trenches on the right and get dug in. We must protect the priest. Or Landy, bring me the vox. The lives of my troops are more important than an annoying priest in the box. I'm going to surrender him. Yeah. Landy, fall back to the trenches and protect the priest. Vastil, pick 4 scouts and come with me. We're taking it to the ambushers. Vastil whoops as you and he and your 4 best skirmishers dive into the trenches to the left of the road. Now we'll show 'em, he shouts. Behind you, Landy and the rest of the company pull back to the trenches to the right of the road, dragging the complaining priest with them. They hunker down and fire slugs and sizzling rays across at the ambushers, distracting them and allowing you and Vastil and your squad to run through the left-hand trenches toward the shattered construct. Which of the squad should we tackle first, Captain? Asks Vastil. You pause at an intersection of trenches. The enemy is in 3 squads. The squad to the left is launching explosive shells across the road into your company. The squad to the right is moving forward through the maze, laying down pinning fire as they come. The squad firing from the shoulders of the fallen construct has a heavy-grade heater and is turning the earth and rocks around the 4 trenches into boiling slag with every sweep. Take out the launcher first. Take out the heater first. I'll take out the skirmishers. The launcher. Is the launcher the squad to the left? Explosive shells? The skirmishers, yeah, those are the ones who are advancing forward, laying down pinning fire. Turning the earth and rocks around the 4 trenches. Yeah. I don't know. I really don't know which is the best option. I'm gonna take, that heater will cut off our escape if we don't take it out. Straight ahead. Working your way through the maze of trenches, you find a position just below and to the left of the construct that gives you a perfect vantage on the heater squad. By the light of their camp torch, you can see there are 7 of them, a spotter, the heater operator, 4 snipers, and a sergeant barking orders. None of them are looking your way. Well, that's foolish of them. There's too many to pick off at a time. Try the singularity detonator. Do we have that? A detonator would draw too much attention. Each of you call 2 targets. But there's 7 of them. I think there is too many. I mean, we're still gonna have 5 on us. And there's 5 of us, right? There's too many to pick off one at a time. Try the singularity detonator. You prime the cipher and overhand it toward the heater crew. A perfect throw. They stare in horror as the ovoid lands among them. Then it implodes, sucking all air and matter within a 10-meter radius into a single point. The heater and most of the crew vanish in a deafening thunderclap as the surrounding air rushes in to fill the space they no longer occupy. Unfortunately, one of the snipers was just out of the radius, and he starts shrieking and firing your way. You duck into cover and pick him off as he pops up for a shot, but his warnings have been heard. Shouting is coming from both the skirmishers and the launcher crew. As you try to decide which way to run, the launcher crew acts, and the bright arc of an incendiary cipher rises above you, then drops down right toward your position. You shout at your squad to scatter, but it's too late. The cipher explodes 10 meters over your heads, showering liquid fire down on everything within a 20-meter radius of you. You are covered in stripes of it that burn you instantly to the bone. Beside you, Vastil staggers around, his head a charred lump. You reach for him, but your hands are on fire. The last thing you hear is the fire kills you by inches, and the flame-red rain beats down on the side of your face is the sound of Landy and the rest of your company rising up out of their trenches and racing to their certain doom to avenge your brave and glorious death. Okay. I'm gonna try another option, guys. I'll be right back. I know I can't... At least I'm pretty sure... You can't enter these things again. Yeah. But I can load a save. Okay. Try this one. We're wide open targets while that launcher is up. We'll take them out first. Ahead left. Working your way around or through the maze of trenches, you circle around the launch squad and come at them from the left. By the light of their globe, you can see there are only four of them. A spotter, a gunner, a loader, and a sergeant barking orders. None of them are looking your way. There's only four of these. A detonator would draw too much attention. Let's pick them off quietly, on my signal. You and your soldiers, crack shots all, take your time picking your targets, then, on your whispered order, all fire together, short, precise shots that drop the entire crew at once, as silent and sure as flesh-eating gas. You wait a moment, but neither of the other two squads seem to have yet noticed the demise of the launcher crew, so you advance to their position and take their weapons, including the launcher. Vastil grins at you. Plenty of ammo left for this little darling, Captain. Shall we give these dirty ambushers a taste of their own medicine? Okay. It probably would draw too much attention. Using the launcher will draw too much attention. Advance on the skirmishers before they close with the rest of the company. As you start forward, both the heater squad and the skirmishers notice that the launcher has stopped firing and look for the cause. From their high vantage point, the heater squad sees the dead launcher crew first and cries a warning to the skirmishers, who start to circle back to investigate, sending forward dark, loping shapes you hadn't noticed before. Running back to the launcher is not an option. There is no way you will get off another round before the skirmishers are upon you. I don't know. They're all, like, formidable foes, right? Find cover. Prepare to meet the skirmishers. Your squad dives into an earth-roofed command post just as a pair of hulking, frilled balls leaps into the trench and charges in at you. You and Vastil fire at them, burning white light through their hearts and brains, and they drop dead at your feet. I guess those are animals? hulking frilled bull. I'm not even sure. The skirmishers pour in right behind them, however, firing in all directions before your squad can recover. Fortunately, they're shooting in the dark, and only one of your soldiers is hit. After that, it's all hand-to-hand, and there you have the advantage. Your squad have fought in the endless battle for years, and are expert close-in fighters. It's over in less than a minute, and you have only lost two. Bastille grins and wipes blood from his face. Time to take that heat out that heater, eh, Captain? There are only four of you now, and Vastiel, though he'd never admit it, is half-blind from a cut over his eye. While there are at least seven of the Chalcedon's best dug in and on around the dead construct, it would be suicide, but if you succeeded, you might at least give Landy the opportunity to get the Aeon Priest, spelled wrong, and the rest of the company away. On the other hand, maybe if you returned to the company, you could somehow avoid the heater and get everyone away. Do we dare? Fall back to the company. An assault is too risky. Slipping out of the underground command post, you and your soldiers start winding back toward the road, hugging the trench walls as much as possible to stay out of sight. It isn't enough. The enemy spots you almost immediately, and heater blasts and beamer fire scream in all around you as you dodge and dive. Vastiel goes down screaming, a perfect cauterized hole through his knee, and you and the other soldiers instinctively turn back to drag him into cover. That's when the heater finds you, turning the ground beneath you into boiling lava, into which you fall as your feet vaporize at the ankles. You begin to burn, and there is nothing and no one to pull you out. The last thing you hear as consciousness begins to leave you and the night-black rain beats down upon your upturned face is the sound of Landy and the rest of the company rising up out of their trenches to avenge you and racing to their certain doom. I guess I'll do everything as before, only assault it in a suicidal attack. We'll see how that goes. Okay, let's see if this might work. Move in, assault the heater squad. Racing from the command post, your squad winds toward the construct, hugging the leeward walls of the trenches to stay hidden. It isn't enough. Plasma blasts and beamer fire scream over their heads with every step. Finally, you make it into range, miraculously unscathed, and heave your last singularity detonator at the crew where it crouches by the construct's massive head. Unfortunately, a blast blinds you as you release, and the detonator bounces off the side of the construct into the rubble. The 10-meter sphere of emptiness that appears as the detonator implodes makes the construct shift and drop, and the enemy crew staggers as they try to catch their balance. With a cry of triumph, you and your soldiers surge up out of the trench, howling and firing as they run. Their beams cut down one crew member after another, but one takes cover behind the heater and swings it wildly in your general direction. Vastiel is caught in the ray and becomes a cloud of meat-scented steam. The other two soldiers dive to avoid it, but are cooked where they lay. Only you are left, and the beam is swinging toward you. With a last desperate leap, you finally get a line of sight on the operator and drill him through the heart, but the beam of the heater is still sweeping your way and vaporizes your legs and lower torso as you hit the ground. The last thing you hear as consciousness begins to leave you and the silver rain beats down upon your upturned face is the cheers and wails of your company, celebrating your victory and mourning your death. The end has come, but at least it was glorious. So you can't win. You can't, like, not die in this. Unless I just have to pick another option. Maybe we need to attack the skirmishers first. If the skirmishers are closing, they must have some hidden strength. Let's ambush them before they reach the company. Head right. Working your way through the trenches, you get ahead of the skirmishers, and Alavouche, your sapper, lays traps at a choke point, while you and the others find hidden vantages that will allow you to pick off the survivors of the blasts. A moment later, the first scouts appear, creeping into the intersection and looking all around. The first and second miss Alvish's traps, but the third is not so lucky. A crackling eruption of electricity shoots through him, then chains to the other scouts and the troops behind. A quarter of them die instantly, hearts stopped by the shock. More lie twitching in the mud. The rest surge forward and trigger a second mine, killing even more. As you shoot the survivors, a roar distracts you. A pair of dark, loping shapes are bounding for you. Frilled balls, the skirmisher's hidden weapon. You and Vastil cook one with your beamers, but the other downs one of your troopers and tears her throat out before the squad can kill it. Worst, fighting it gives the other squads time to find you. The beam of the heater sweeps your way. The bright arc of an incendiary cipher drops down toward your position. You shout at your crew to scatter, but it's too late. The round explodes over your head, showering liquid fire upon you. Vastil staggers past you, his head a charred lump. You reach for him, but your hands are on fire. Huh. The last thing you hear is the fire kills you by inches and the flame-red rain beats down. On the side of your face is the sound of Landy and the rest of the company rising up out of their trenches and racing to their certain doom to avenge your brave and glorious death. So we have the answer. Attack the launcher, people. First, then get cover and attack the skirmishers, and then make a suicide run towards the, the heater and the construct. I have one more to find. Who's the singer and who's the song? So tune back for next episode, which will be the final episode when we find the Ovoid Merecaster from Dracogen. Thanks for watching, guys. See you next time, and endure. In enduring, grow strong.